Hello.
Hi, Armin.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Good, thanks. How's everything been?
The same for everyone, interplanetary in a capsule at home. But I think that we've adjusted pretty well remotely. How are you guys doing?
Yeah, pretty good. A bit slower, but things have been growing and a bit, taking on a bunch of really interesting projects and things like that. But you're right. I mean, everyone's been impacted by COVID, so.
Yeah, I
But
mean,
happy 2021.
I know exactly. Happy New Year. And thank you so much for agreeing to be our first guest this year. I think it's great considering the fact that a lot of people during 2020 have used the time at home or the remote work opportunity to think up a lot of ideas for themselves or their projects. But you were really, really good at taking ideas and kind of materializing and instantiating them. And so I imagine your 2021 is looking pretty good.
I tell you, some things have been great, but other things have been incredibly slow. Luckily, we've got two sides to the business. There's the artificial intelligence side that we don't really talk about so much. And then there's the other side of it, which is these workshops that we do, and that, oh, not being able to get together with people has inevitably been impacted. But yeah, I mean, on the other side, we've grown quite a bit more.
Okay, well, that's great to hear. And I'm not gonna ask you to like break any confidentiality agreements or anything like that in terms of the AI side. But I think that we as at SFI have experienced the same thing. Our capacity to kind of advance in our research is really grounded in how we convene a variety of individuals and meetings. And we're managing to do that remotely, but I don't know, there's some energy lost when you don't get the face-to-face transmission. But I was just thinking it might be good for our audience to have a sense of what it is that you do with the Exploration Institute, why you founded it. And I have this in my background as a reminder. I'm not sure if you're like able to talk about it, but the last time we spoke, you had a lot of really interesting things in the works for what I think was Ocean Planet.
Well, that's been one of the projects that's unfortunately ground down to a halt.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So I don't know if there's a lot that we can talk about, but I mean, the conference went great, but soon after that, there was the complete lockdown of life as we know
Right.
it. So I don't know what to say about that part. To answer that initial question, why did I start it? There's an unofficial reason, and then there's the more strategic thing about the immediate need that we're trying to fulfill. So long term, I think we should become a multiplanetary species. And I think that instead of having a military industrial complex, I'd like to see an exploration industrial complex. What I really want to see happen is that I would love for us to make Star Trek become reality. To me, that is an exciting future to live in. I think that would just be cool. I would love nations to, outdo each other in terms of how much exploration they do. I'd love our clubs to be replaced from, nuclear weapons and things that do humanity harm
Right.
to vessels of exploration, better ways of thinking, painting a future that people would want to be involved with. And also, I think if we don't do that, we have a danger that we've got this planet and it's under enormous pressure right now, from an ecosystem point of view. But if we were to expand way out there, well, there's no limits to what we could do, where we could go, how many people we could become. Then I think we would be able to create artificial intelligence, which I see as one of the fundamental dangers to humanity right now in this finite world, as being a servant of humanity when we push out.
You don't think that AI could in some way be of utility to us in a peaceable pushing out into the world, or?
Look, it's a tool, right? If we apply it the right way, it'll be amazing. If we look at the Earth as a finite, stomping ground for humanity, artificial intelligence will inevitably be something that's going to lead to loss of freedom for individuals. And yeah, that's going to put us in a very dangerous situation.
Well, so that being the case, are you excited about what prospects there are for instance, a return to the moon or all of the Mars missions that we have planned? Are there other things that you think we should be doing in the next decade that aren't exactly on the books yet?
I'm excited for both. I think
Okay.
this should happen. What I would love to see is that while SpaceX is really pushing for settlements on Mars, I'd love to see Blue Origin double down on settlements around low Earth orbit.
Okay.
you know, that's what I'd love to see. I'd love for us to actually create a, you know, an ecosystem where someone who has the passion and the desire could get a job in space. Right now, if someone has a passion and desire to get a job in Hawaii, they can, right? So why can't we do the same about with space? Well, the reason is that the business model isn't there. I mean, technologically, we're not that far away. Mm-hmm. Really, we're not that far away for low Earth orbit. I mean, if SpaceX is successful, if Blue Origin is successful, within the next decade, we're going to have 8,000 times, like three orders of magnitude more ability to launch things into Earth orbit as we do today. I mean, mm-hmm. I mean, like, think about how incredible and exciting that could be.
You know, yeah, I think on a personal level, you know, whenever you come to a sort of personal crossroads and you decide you're going to break it up and you're going to relocate, the idea of space as an option, unlike New York City or San Francisco or wherever it is, I like that the adventurous might have the possibility to just completely separate and re-engage in lower Earth orbit or elsewhere.
This is, I think, a fundamental solution. You know, looking at challenging situations day in, day out, one of the things that I notice is that people try to solve problems by basically saying, point A, point B, let's take the halfway and let's compromise. I mean, that does work. Compromise does work. But I've, from a creative point of view, I think it's probably the most boring way of solving a problem, right? What I'd love to see is fundamentally different ways of solving problems where, you know, the solution is what wasn't even imagined before. A lot of the problems that we have right now on this planet could be fundamentally solved, like at root level solved. Uh-huh. By expanding out into space. Environmental issues, social issues, economic issues, so many things could be solved.
Yeah.
That's cool.
That is very cool. And it reminds me a little bit of, we had Space for Humanity out in 2019, and Rachel Lyons gave this fabulous lecture about the social impact that the overview effect would have were more people to have the privilege to experience it. And so I agree that there's a lot that would be fundamentally resolved by what would you call that? A dilution of the population on Earth, right? If we dilute the amount of individuals on Earth and we place them somewhere else and we have the capacity to experience what's happening on Earth from a completely new perspective, I think obviously unforeseen solutions would present themselves. And it's an out there, like it's literally a moonshot proposal, but I think that it's fundamentally capacious. Would you do it? Are you a space-bound individual?
Of course. What about you?
I don't know. I'm very earthbound. I think if I'm successful in my position with Interplanetary, it's because I love this planet so much that I think, as you described, expanding beyond space is a really excellent way of resolving so many things that could shorten the lifespan of the planet. And I want to extend the lifespan of this planet as far as possible. But I really like being on it. I'm not so adventurous myself.
You know, the point isn't so much to go and live out there. I think the point is to understand that it's a place and an environment where there's the option of living out there or being there. You know, when it comes to how most people live their lives, one of the things that I've noticed is that we all have this tendency, don't we, to like react to situations. And I think the idea of being able to just slow down, like 0 miles an hour, and then get the big perspective of what's going on is a fundamental part of solving a problem. Being in a reactionary mode, none of us can solve a problem. So I think space offers that opportunity as well to get the perspective, to get the, you know, to just be in a different domain for a period of time.
Yeah, and as you say, I think that a reactive nature or a reactive approach to problem solving kind of binds you in a bit because suddenly you're building steps towards this, you know, inescapable pathway towards whatever solution emerges. I don't know, we become very path dependent when we react quickly to what we believe is a quick band-aid of a solution to a problem. I agree with you. Better to be slow and proactive than fast and reactive.
And when you force someone to make a decision and you give them two options, you know, there's not a whole lot of room for creativity.
Yeah, why is it that the solutions that are often selected are exactly that, selected? Why isn't the person who's responsible for resolving the problem ever really given the opportunity to be creative, as you say? Where is the space for creative problem solving?
I don't know. I think it's maybe culturally we don't allow ourselves to be like genuinely creative. Like, mm-hmm. I think culturally, listening isn't something that that's encouraged. Hmm. You know, I mean, really listening.
Yeah.
Like, we're too quick to judge.
Yeah, I wonder. Just there is this kind of very special thing that humans have, and it's this capacity to adjudicate, to make judgment. And I think we've sort of fostered that in our minds as the end all be all greatest characteristic that we possess. And I wonder if it's that, like, honoring that capacity to such a degree has limited the growth of other capacities, like being creative, like listening well. It's almost as if, you know, in an effort to evolve or survive in nature, we've really, really relied upon this capacity to judge, and we just use it too fast. It's the card that we employ too often. And maybe we've stunted ourselves in some capacity in that way.
And the underlying incentives seem to be pushing us in that direction more and more. You know, if you are someone who feels that you're getting a like or something like that through social media is a good thing,
yeah.
Then, I mean, there's an underlying sort of promotion for behavior there.
Right. And so then perhaps, I mean, here's an opportunity to be creative in problem solving, is to recalibrate what incentives motivate individuals to behave in a certain way. Yeah, I don't know. Is it possible? I know that you said that it's kind of come to a halt, but could you explain a little bit about what your thoughts are behind Ocean Planet? When we last spoke about it, it seems I really admired the project because it's so multifaceted and transdisciplinary and complex in everything that it manages to capture. And I had never really thought about the ocean as a means to do everything that you've seen it capable of doing. So I would love it if you would explain for our audience a little bit why it is that you are shifting focus a bit to the ocean of all things.
I'm so honored that you remembered such details.
Thanks. I was really excited about the project, so I'm excited to hear more.
Given that the vast majority of the planet is covered with water, you know, it's the ocean, why are we calling the Earth Earth? Shouldn't it be ocean, you know? It's a funny way to frame things because I feel that there's so much going on in the ocean right now that we just take for granted. You know, every other breath that we take comes from the ocean. Why are we using the ocean in the ways that we are? Why are we so careless about certain aspects? But also, why are we not thinking about the ocean as a frontier for, you know, thoughtful growth? Because we really can. From living space to exploration to new areas of economy. I mean, it's just waiting for us. It's a cool environment. When I think about the ocean, I kind of think about it in one of two ways. One is an area of opportunity, and then the other is an area that needs thoughtful attention. Not scare tactics, not making people become concerned that we're about to do something terrible.
Right.
Believe you me, there's areas that that are not looking so good right now. But I think more to the point, we've got to be looking at it from a point of, from the angle that the ocean is in need of thoughtful attention. Think about the users of the ocean. You know, we've got the military, we've got all sorts of commerce taking place. We've got resource extraction. You've got, you know, tourism. There's undersea cables connecting continents. I mean, there's so many things. But at the same time, we're not really thinking too much about it. And as a result, the ocean is in the state that it's in, right? So I would love for people who are involved in one area of the ocean to start to think about their impact overall and start to have discussions with other verticals in different, but, you know, using the same domain.
And that would include also kind of non-human endeavors. If we think about users of the ocean, I wasn't sure if you were going to limit that to our use of it. And I think use is a good term, but there's also the entire really complex ecology that exists in the ocean, these deep sea extremophile species that managed to do so much with so little. And I think that it would be really interesting to view how it is, for instance, that commerce practices or military practices completely impact or depend upon those species and vice versa. There's so many interdependencies and those links that I'm so curious about.
You know, here's a little story that I think is really interesting. And I don't think a lot of people are aware of this, but some time ago, we used to use whale blubber for lighting. And it was an environmental plea to start shifting over to kerosene lamps, right? To save those poor whales, we decided to start using petroleum products. Mm-hmm. And okay, so we expanded that, and then we allowed some of the whales to live, and so on. So that was kind of an interesting shift. But one thing we never really understood was, why are whales important in the ocean at all? Mm-hmm. Until recently. The solution is, you know, what they do is actually pretty fundamental, because they go down to the bottom of the ocean, bring up nitrates to the top, and poop. And their poop helps to fertilize phytoplankton. Mm-hmm. And without phytoplankton, obviously, at the base of the food chain, we would have a lot of, you know, we'd be in trouble.
Yeah, a lot of starving animals, including ourselves. Yeah, also, and I hope that I'm not misrepresenting this information, but I was working with an artist, hopefully to have come to Interplanetary this past year. Of course, no festivals in 2020. I'm still bitter about it, but we'll fix it this year. But there's an artist that I was working with named Tim Weaver, who was going to do this audiovisual performance called Whale Fall. Because what happens too is that when whales die, their bones are of a certain density that they sink all the way to the bottom of the ocean. And they're kind of cavernous and architectural in a way that they create almost a habitat space for a struggling species. And so there's this really like beautiful sacrificial element that whales contribute to the overall success of the ecology of an ocean that I just thought that was very beautiful. But yeah, so whales, glad we stopped using them for energy. But of course our transition, as you say, was very reactive and band-aid. Now we're reliant on oil and have been for so long. Maybe we need to shift away from that. What's next, you know?
We always do the best that we know how to at the time, right, with the information that we do. So like, we're never going to solve problems, you know, if we had the hindsight of infinite time and infinite resources, right? So we're going to be making mistakes throughout history, and we're going to be doing the right things at that moment. But in hindsight, you know, there's going to be all sorts of, you know, perspectives that we wouldn't have at the time we're doing things. Mm-hmm. Same with, you know, wind energy. Mm-hmm. I mean, we thought we were doing such a wonderful thing, and it certainly lends itself to this idealistic view that we can have free energy from, you know, gusts of wind, right? But the reality of it is that we've come to realize that every 10 years you have to replace the blades, and you can't, you know, recycle those blades. What are you going to do, send them to landfill? How much energy does it take to make each one of those blades? Well, we're not getting that much back.
Right.
And it's intermittent, and it's doing all sorts of fun, funky things to, you know, the local ecosystems and the birds and so on. What would we have done it if we had known that these are going to be the outcomes? I don't know.
Hmm. No, but I appreciate your perspective. I guess I'm often upset when we realize that we've made mistakes in our attempt to solve problems. But you're right. You know, we have the information that we have at the moment. We're usually well intended when we attempt to employ it, and maybe we should, I don't know, give ourselves a little bit of slack in the history of innovation and solution.
Absolutely.
Well, so if I may, I'd like to shift to the actual crux of the conversation and ask you about your alien artifacts. So I'm going to say the question in its entirety, taken from the Strugatsky novel, Roadside Picnic: at the risk of great personal peril, imprisonment, or even death, what object would you hope to uncover from an alien crash site zone, and why?
Okay. I would love to grab a device that allows us to hold it in our hands and allow someone else to hold it at the same time. And each person gets to completely understand the other person's perspective without judgment and without the passage of time. Just to truly, 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 truly stop and understand the other person's feelings, perspectives, experiences, cognition, you know, where they're at, how they reach that decision in a very kind of non-judgmental way. And then there's a button on this that allows us to then press it and expand our mind so much more that it allows both points of view to sort of merge and meld and come up with a better solution.
I totally understand the merits of that device for it to work in that way. But could you go ahead and articulate what benefit would be gained from such a shared understanding, like a true shared understanding between individuals?
Take it to a war zone.
Okay, I see. Just like lieutenant to lieutenant, that kind of a thing.
Or dictator to dictator. Hmm. Yeah, take it to UN General Assembly. Do a world tour with this device.
Right. Okay, so that's good that you say it that way. So it's a very precious item. There's only one. And therefore, it in order for that experience to be distributed, the actual item has to be traveling around the world at all times, correcting understandings between individual human beings.
Yeah.
So who then would be in control of, who would get to decide when and where that's for use? I would say this is one object that I've heard of so far in the series that I can't imagine being weaponized yet. I don't think that an evil person could convince a non-evil person to understand evilness and become evil, right? I don't see this being weaponized. But then how is it decided who needs to touch the object, whatever we decide it looks like or is?
That's a good question. I would imagine that someone who gets to connect with this device would instantaneously appreciate the power that it has. Mm-hmm. To unite people. And then from there, you know, the next person would be added to this group, and then the next and the next and the next. And then, you know, it's an accumulative sort of situation.
Yeah, by virtue of its singularity, it's sort of a grassroots conscious change, which is really cool. I love a grassroots emergence. Okay, so obviously, yes, it would be kind of a peaceable object. What about intellectually? Like you say conscious and emotions and understanding, perspective, experience, but is there a possibility too that this device would allow for like a transference of understanding, for instance, of artificial intelligence, right? If I didn't understand machine learning, but I shared this object with someone who was a computer scientist and did, would I get that benefit as well, do you think? Or I don't know, what are its limitations?
If you think that feature needs to happen, then we can add that.
So we don't need to add it. The aliens left it and we get what we get. I'm wondering if you agree or disagree that it could be an intellectual transference as well.
Well, I think usually a lot of intellectual understanding in a particular topic comes from, you know, an improved perspective on that subject. So the more we understand it, the more we can then connect the dots and form a model. I think it would definitely lead us there. Imagine if, for example, you had this amazing awareness of fundamental physics, and I had, you know, a friend who had an understanding of psychology, right? And then you and my friend were able to connect, and then all of a sudden, like, your perspective on fundamental physics and my friend's perspective on psychology would sort of meld, and like all of a sudden you would know so much more because you're both deep experts in that particular, in these two fields, and it's like one person knowing all of these important deep insights.
Right, and what you might learn about your own void in your expertise by engaging with this other expert and their void and their expertise, how each informs the other.
Absolutely. You know, sometimes I say things like, it doesn't win me any favors, but I say that, you know, the biggest problem with science is scientists. And that's not to be critical of scientists, of course. I mean, I consider myself as a scientist, but it's that sometimes when we feel like we've become an expert, we stop listening, right? And that's a human trait. And it's not the trait of the actual underlying subject that we're trying to study. So we prevent ourselves from digging in a little bit deeper. We become experts in some field and we have resistance in certain areas, and we stop having this awe and wonder like a child might, mm-hmm. you know, going into the field. And so I think that what this kind of thing would do is that instead of a fundamental scientist who at times I've seen would poo-poo kind of a, someone who deals with humanities, they just drop that judgment and they kind of understand where they're coming from. And also the other way around, There's no intimidation factor.
Right. You know? Right. I think that's actually a really valuable point. And it speaks to a lot of what I think Santa Fe Institute hopes Interplanetary will accomplish. Obviously, we're rooted in science. We're a scientific research center. But Interplanetary is rooted so much in creativity and imagination and arts and film and literature and media, science fiction, what have you. I find often when I'm trying to merge arts and science, which I think deserve to be coupled, maybe there's a lack of respect towards the artist by the scientist, or maybe there's a lack of imagination and flexibility on behalf of the scientist, you know, from the perspective of the artist. This, I think, would do a lot in resolving that. And it hasn't happened perfectly yet, but I think we're getting closer and closer.
Well, it's all the human kind of experience, isn't it? Well, the pursuit of knowledge and the pursuit of different fields and being the best version of ourselves and trying to sort of learn something as much as we possibly can, given the tools that we have and so on. I think it's as much a limitation in fundamental physics as it is in arts. Mm-hmm. I don't think we're fundamentally that different, no matter what pursuits we sort of regard as, you know, the most interesting. And I think partly the reason why I don't think we're that different is because I don't think we're anywhere as smart as we think we are. You know, I hope that's not an offensive thing to say, but I mean,
I don't think so.
Well, I mean, we all sort of get in the zone, and when we're there, we think we're so smart and so on. But how often has it been that you write something? I know it's happened plenty of times with me, but I write something and I leave it alone for a period of time, and then I come back and I look back on it and I'm like, what was I thinking? Yeah.
So by virtue of the fact that this question is kind of rooted in an objective, artifactual space, can you try to attempt to explain to me what you think this shared object would look like or feel like, or how you would recognize it in the zone?
Maybe spherical.
Okay.
And kind of... something that wouldn't have maybe too many features, unassuming.
Uh-huh. Well, that makes sense, right? You want an unassuming object to allow individuals to, in the use of it, kind of jettison their assumptions.
Yeah, and there's no instructions for how to use it. It's so simple. You will know how to use it the moment you get in contact with it.
Or if there's no instructions and it's found by an individual, it might be a very long time before someone has the thought to share the object simultaneously with another. It might go unused for decades, who knows, until, I don't know, someone finds something, someone precious or someone worth sharing that with, and then explosively the device's capacity is revealed, and then it goes on its world tour.
Good idea.
Yeah. I guess the expression of this object as the device you'd like to find underlines what I guess you see as a lack of empathy or something like that between individuals when attempting to resolve an issue. Is that correct? It's something.
Oh, yeah. And by the way, you can apply this for physics too. You know, you could have two mathematicians or two physicists or two cosmologists or, you know, two genetics experts sitting down who have slightly different perspectives on a subject, and boom, you know, all of a sudden you've solved it.
Right, it's like the attempted string theory, right? It's like you got the relativists, you've got quantum, and then you've got gravitational people. And maybe if they each touch the stone, we'd suddenly understand this big paradox in physics that's been bothering us for so long. No, I think this is a really beautiful object. And it would, I think, it points to the fact, if it's possessed by these aliens and they left it behind, it points to the fact that they are likely much more sophisticated than we are. And I like that. It's nice to be reminded of the hubris of humanity. We might not be the end all be all.
I hope you're right. Now, why would they be visiting us?
Good question. It's actually in the book itself, in Roadside Picnic, there's this proposal that they weren't visiting us, that we're so nothing that they just needed to, for instance, take a pit stop, maybe go to the restroom, get a snack on their way to a better destination. And Earth was just like a place for them to land in the meanwhile. And they have no idea what they left behind and how much that will change us. But the hypothesis is that we were completely unnoticed, that we're so insignificant. But why do you think? Do you think there's something worthwhile for an extraterrestrial species to come in search for?
You know, I've thought for at least the last, 15 years on and off about, how would we recognize an intelligence greater than our own? Primarily thinking about, all the space stuff and thinking, well, if we did recognize an alien species, well, really, what's to say that we haven't already met them? Maybe their intelligence is so much greater than we don't realize them. We don't recognize their intelligence. Almost like saying, does a mouse or a cockroach, do they recognize the intelligence of a primate? And I doubt they do. So I think if we can recognize an intelligence a little bit greater than our own because of the outcomes of their activities. But fundamentally, beyond a certain, event horizon of recognition, if you will, right?
Yeah.
I think it's going to be very difficult. Maybe they're doing things at much different scales than what we would recognize as intelligent manipulation.
If you thought that there was a way to demonstrate our intelligence to an extraterrestrial species, what would you send them? What would be what you think is the actually existing? This is another object question, but I've never asked it before. Is there something that we possess that you think you could show to an extraterrestrial intelligent species that they would recognize as like valuable in terms of their judgment of humanity?
I could say, send them works of literature, right? And they would look at it and they would say, it's okay, whatever. or we could play them some music or something like that, and they might not like it, right? Or some painting, or show our deep understanding of the universe, and they might think it's pathetic. But I think the thing that, if possible, it'd be a big hug.
Okay, so like a physical expression of love, a shared love somehow.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think our understanding of pretty much everything is time sensitive. Over a period of time, our understanding of physics has changed. Our understanding of so many things has changed. And so I kind of like to sort of think about most information as just that. It's information, but the context of it is it an idea? Is it a hypothesis? Is it a theory? Is it a law? Mm-hmm. Very few things do I know are actually facts, right? The closest I've come to thinking of something that's a universal fact is this idea of, love.
Yeah.
And so maybe we should love aliens. I don't know.
Yeah.
Demonstrate love or something like that. I think that notion could be quite powerful if they're able to receive it.
I think that's absolutely beautiful. And I agree. And what's interesting too is that the hug as it exists between individuals on Earth is almost as close as we can get to this object that you've invented, right? You can't specifically transfer experience or an understanding in totality as you described, but I think that to share a hug with an individual is always understood. Did you think of this kind of object pretty immediately when I asked you to be on the show? Did it come instinctively?
Yeah. As soon as I understood it, because this is something that I've been working on for a long time, it's not as clean as having some sort of a spherical ball that, you can do stuff like that with, but the idea of it is something that I think is very important for us as humanity, because, we're at a point where we can destroy ourselves any day through bad ideas. It's funny, actually, Caitlin, I think the biggest threat to humanity isn't, proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. That's obviously a big deal. Yeah, it's a terrible thing. I don't think it's environmental degradation. These are big, difficult subjects, but and so on. I think the biggest threat to humanity is the spread of bad ideas. Because, the spread of bad ideas will unleash all of these other terrible things.
I don't know how to, you can't eradicate bad ideas from the world.
We could encourage a cultural kind of realization that we as humanity need to slow down and listen to each other better, but fundamentally listen to each other without judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that would surely slow down the spread of bad ideas.
Yeah, I think it's funny. I've been in this headspace because of coronavirus and because of 2020, and I have this epidemiological idea of how economies break down, ecologies increase, virus spreads, et cetera. But this sort of the speed through which bad ideas do make their way, proliferate their way through the minds of individuals is kind of viral in its impact. And we were obviously not very good at quelling that, try as we might, but this is even harder because of its immateriality. The idea of just, as you say, slowing down and truly listening as a sort of vaccine for this terrible thing that could be our undoing is worth sitting down and thinking about.
You know, maybe Santa Fe Institute in general could think about what a healthy social media platform should look like. You know, one that has the underlying dynamics that gets people to a better point of understanding rather than the underlying dynamics that forces people to be isolated and confrontational.
That's a great question. How would someone of that opinion approach a technology like this with the aim towards openness as opposed to kind of echo chambery conflict?
Yes. Because, I mean, like the dynamics right now, finite number of characters and having an argument in front of a whole bunch of people who are waiting to see who's going to punch who first.
Right.
You know, I mean, of course, we're going to have this kind of an output.
Yeah, it's like the Colosseum.
It is.
It's clearly something that we are going to hold on to for a long time. Like, we're never jettisoning a social media form of a platform. We just haven't come up with the right one yet, I guess.
What they came up with was the most obvious, the most linear way of thinking, and the most obvious way to code, mm-hmm. right? But there wasn't a whole lot of thought put into, you know, let's create something that with the dynamics of it allows us to come together and be more thoughtful and grow as individuals and, you know, learn different perspectives in ways that we weren't able to before.
Right. And part of the love that has to do with like how concise you have to be on something like Twitter, that you can only say 140 characters, then you almost have to distill what is a very complex and multifaceted idea into a brief claim. And then suddenly it's like a ghost of itself.
Well, but what you're saying is so true. I just don't think that they thought about it. And also there's another component to this. You know, communications requires two types of commitment. Commitment from the speaker, you know, to be articulate, to be accurate, to be diplomatic when needed. I'm not saying nice, but I'm saying diplomatic.
Okay.
And then there's a commitment also on the side of the listener to listen accurately, to really look for what the speaker is trying to say rather than what they wish the speaker had said or what they would like the speaker to say so that they have justification to take out the club. Mm-hmm. You know, so these two forms of commitment to good communications are not enabled by social media right now.
Well, what comes to mind as you say that is almost the introduction of a sort of contract, right? Like if you're going to engage in the social media platform, maybe you have to commit to some sort of a pre-existing contract about how it is that you approach what communications you see and what communications you put out there. Of course, I guess that introduces the possibility of like law and punishment or being blocked or whatever, and that exists. But the social contract as an idea before you get to communicate or before you get to engage with other people's communications might be like one step towards resolving that.
I think you're right. I mean, when you've got 100,000 people listening to every sort of thing that you're saying, right, there's a duty of care. But also this should really expand to all sorts of other fields too, not just social media. It just so happens that it's so obvious that social media is more powerful than we thought it might be.
Right.
But so is artificial intelligence. I mean, this is not in the hands of someone who isn't completely aware of how dangerous it could be, artificial intelligence could be ridiculously dangerous.
There's a few of the researchers in the community with the Santa Fe Institute are almost kind of drawing up a contract for the development of algorithm in AI, which is like an ethical contract, so to speak. It's like, you can, to the best of your ability, assert your intention to do this by good, but you also have to recognize that there are unforeseen possibilities, and they're trying to work out almost like a, not a, I don't know if a contract is the right word, but almost like a Hippocratic oath thing for people who develop these technologies, right? It would force people to have to think about those possibilities before releasing anything into the world.
To think about the level of destruction that AI is capable of, you know, to unleash about the same level of destruction of the Second World War within days, you know, is something that we have to start to sort of get some level of awareness around. And that's why I think we need to slow down a lot more, you know, because there's so much happening that, you know, the possibility of getting caught in a reactionary sort of response to everything is becoming a more and more likely scenario. So,
yeah, I think that is becoming, I hope that is becoming more and more apparent how easily we could find ourselves in this extremely dangerous reactive form of communication.
You know, you said a little bit earlier that, you know, people are generally trying to do the right thing. Well, part of the pathology of ideas spreading is that every individual who's spreading that idea thinks that they're trying to do a good thing.
Right.
You know, how many people do you know who say, I was trying to be a good person? And, you know, what are they saying this to? In judgment of their own actions, the particular outcome that they've had. Sometimes they've been good, sometimes they've been terrible, and sometimes they've been neutral. But nonetheless, we tend to do things because we think we're in the, you know, we're on the right side of history, or we're doing something because it's just a good thing to do. But not having perspective of what that one thing is going to do, what are the knock-on effects and so on. Yeah.
And again, if we had the capacity to, without judgment, truly listen, perhaps we'd recognize the fault in our intentions, that we can't see ourselves when we're cloistered in our attempt to do good.
Well, to be sure, I don't know what the right answer is. Well, I'm smart enough to know that I don't have infinite intelligence, nowhere near that, right? And that's, I think that's a fundamental thing for us to sort of appreciate about ourselves, and also the people that we paint as adversaries. Just slow down.
Just slow down.
What would you like to see happen in 2021?
I mean, I think to our conversation, it would be really wonderful if civil discourse had a renaissance, if people could communicate their true feelings, desires, and thoughts with others who don't absolutely ascribe to the same, and listen such that flexibility reemerges in everyone's individual horizons. If you ask me what my socio-political leanings were 10 years ago, they're very different than they are today. And I think that's because I actively attempt to be open-minded, but I recognize that I'm not perfectly open-minded, no one is. But I think lately, there's a lot of self-affirmation going on, and I do that myself too. I'm not above any of this, but I would really, really love to see a return to thoughtful civil discourse, which is to say, it's similar to, I think, this slowing down and listening without judgment, to truly think through the opinions of others and see where that aligns or disaligns with your own perspective of the world, and what could emerge out of, at the risk of being boring, a compromise between those perspectives.
Has anyone asked you what your device would be?
No, because that would be the end of the series. I can't actually answer that question until we conclude the series, right? But I have the opportunity and privilege to speak with all of these incredible individuals who are so thoughtful from their particular perspective. And that informs what it is that I think about when I think about my object.
Well, can I ask you why you're doing this series?
Good question. So the idea that there might be something greater than what we recognize on our own planet allows us, I think, to be imaginative in the way that we approach how we want to resolve what issues we perceive on the planet Earth. So this series, I think, exists to, one, get to share, like, extra disciplinarily with the people that we invite their opinions about what it's like to exist on this planet, what problems they perceive, if any, what might be a viable solution to that problem, and how that doesn't actually exist on Earth as we know it. It's an opportunity to be kind of creative with people like yourself. And then it, I think, just underlines the varying perspectives that everyone that we work with has. That's what I think the series is.
Well, that's really exciting. And it sounds like it really does lend itself to taking the work that you're doing at Santa Fe Institute and sort of making it more accessible to a broader group of people.
I hope. I think that the same can be said for what you plan to do with Ocean Planet. And if you're not initiated in the sciences, if you're not a scientist yourself, I think it's quite intimidating to try to engage with these big ideas. But there are ways to create entree into those ideas. And I think this might be one way to do it, I hope. Again, this grassroots possibility is extremely important. The ideas that emerge out of a collective and just ensuring that everyone has access to those ideas and can understand them in some way is something that I'm really excited to participate in.
That's incredibly important. I think what you're doing is just so vital. Just encouraging people to think about different issues, sort of concepts, and giving themselves the permission really to dabble.
Permission is a really lovely way to put it. Again, it's the access thing, just not creating these cloisters or relying too heavily on accolade or whatever, you know, that everyone's capable of engaging in whatever capacity they're capable of engaging, and it's all valuable.
I completely agree. And part of that is forgiveness of others and forgiveness of ourselves, and sometimes just letting go so that we can be creative. Because, you know, it's so easy to be distracted by things. Oh, what does this person think of me? You know, well, honestly, if we're able to let go of that and just focus on the business at hand, we allow more of our, you know, mental capacity to do the thing that it needs to do. And that's a skill.
That's a skill. I'm constantly encumbered and aware of that too. You're right, that is a skill. Well, thank you so much for sharing that with me. And thank you so much for being on this show and for your contribution, your object.
Well, thank you for having me.
I wish you a lot of luck in 2021. And we should remain in touch to see how any of our mutual projects develop in case there's an opportunity to help each other. I think that we're both kind of working towards the same endeavor in whatever ways we can.
Yeah, that sounds great. I couldn't agree with you more.